evening and good to have you with us in this edition of the Urban Debate. Viewers, if you listen to the frequent government briefings that are held by the Health Ministry over the state of COVID and our battle against COVID, the last couple of briefings would give you a picture that the situation is improving in our country. They give us details about how the recoveries have been higher than daily cases in the last several days. They give us details of how daily cases themselves are now coming down. So we decided to have a conversation tonight to do a reality check on what really is the situation. How far are we from the peak, or is the peak behind us already for the second wave? So let me just break it down for you before I bring in our panelists. If you take a look at the daily cases, we've seen that there has been a gradual reduction. On May 12th, 3.5 lakh cases were registered in one single day. Early May, we were registering over 4 lakh cases. That came down to 3.5 lakh cases on May 12th. And as of yesterday, it stood at 2.6 lakh cases in 24 hours. But let me also, along with this, say that there is still some concern as far as the high death figures are concerned, where there has not been any let up. In fact, we are still seeing an increase. We are just about 20 days into May, 19 days, and already over 71,000 people have died as per official records. 71,000 as per official records. You know how much of mismatch of data has happened when it comes to deaths due to COVID. So you can imagine what the real figure would be about the loss of life just in the month of May. That being said, let me tell you some of the states that have begun to show a turnaround. On top of that list is Maharashtra. And the reason for Maharashtra's turnaround is actually quite simple. We've now effectively been in a lockdown for almost a month. Tougher curves were announced right in the first week of April for most of the big cities in Maharashtra. So while there are certain pain points that continue, jump in cases in cities like Amravati, districts like Amravati that continue, but big cities like Mumbai have begun to see a turnaround, which is what is visible in Maharashtra's daily cases that have come down. And of course, positivity rate also that has declined now. Lockdown officially was April 22, but before that, for almost 2 weeks, 3 weeks, we saw extremely tight curves. Other states, Uttar Pradesh, has also shown a decline in numbers. It has also shown a decline in its positivity rate. Uttar Pradesh went into a lockdown on 30th of April. So it's now been almost 19 days since that lockdown was announced for the state of Uttar Pradesh. Now, there is a big question mark on the amount of testing that is being done, and so whether these numbers are the actual figures. Nevertheless, this is the trend that official figures show. Similarly, for the state of Bihar, where there has been a decline in the for daily cases that have now come down. Lockdown was announced recently, just 2 weeks ago on May 4th, but the positivity rate also seems to be declining. Now, these are also states where there is a lot more pain in the rural areas, a part of which may be difficult to capture, so keep that in mind. Delhi has seen a significant decline as well. Delhi went into a lockdown from April 20th. So it's been in a state of lockdown for a month now, and you're beginning to see those results as well. The positivity has come down from 34% to 13.6% as far as the national capital is concerned. Madhya Pradesh has shown a similar trend. But there are states. There are states like Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh that haven't seen a turnaround or decline in cases. Yes, continue to show. Tamil Nadu continues to show a rise in cases and positivity rate. West Bengal and several other states from the northeast especially are seeing a higher number of cases now. So that being said, let's say good evening to the experts who are joining me on this conversation. Dr. Sitabra Sinha, professor at the Institute of Mathematical Sciences in Chennai, joins us this evening. Dr. Tanmay Mahapatra, epidemiologist, joins us this evening. Dr. Sunil Agarg, member of the Lancet Commission COVID India Task Force, joins us this evening. Dr. Virender Singh Chauhan, emeritus professor at the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology, with us this evening. Let me actually first up go across to Dr. Sunila Garg and ask her this question. Dr. Garg, what are the key indicators that you personally do look at to sense a change in situation, and how would you judge where we are? Every day we get asked, if the peak of the second wave is here, or is it still to come, or is it gone?
Yeah, thank you so much, Tanvi, for asking me this question and having me on the show. First of all, as a public health expert and as an epidemiologist, what I would like to see is that how the disease is progressing. You know, first of all, overall numbers by themselves can be a marker, but they can also be false markers also. So we have to see very critically. At any stage, I would personally not like the virus, you know, or give the opportunity to the virus to the state, you know, to spread, because Mumbai and Delhi may be peaking. But, you know, also some of the states which you rightly mentioned, like Uttar Pradesh, Gujarat, Karnataka, MP, or Rajasthan, you know, 19 of these states are there total, which are showing a declining trend in last few days. But, you know, when we look at Meghalaya, Mizoram, Andaman, Lakshadweep, Puducherry, Tripura, Ladakh, and all that, you know, or Arunachal, they are showing, you know, the rising trends. You mentioned about Amravati also. Amravati showed, you know, first a decline, then again it went up. So that is another important thing which you have to, you know, view from an epidemiological perspective. We look at, you know, the because our country is divided into so many countries, kind of. So we need to look at, and within the countries, there are districts by themselves, you know, which have a huge population. And then we have a rural part, we have an urban part also, for which we came out with a separate set of guidelines. Personally, I was there with Niti Aayog to draft these guidelines. So it is important to look from that perspective. But you see, another thing which is also, I will look at the pandemic together with the vaccination coverage as well. So many important things are there. And, you know, apart from that, you know, number of cases which are affected, which are young cases, which are old cases. So overall, you know, we have to take a picture from a epidemiological perspective and how you see the disease is behaving, because this is only, I will say, a kind of a projection for, you know, a period of time that the number of cases have come down. But we need to look at state by state. We need to look within the state as per district and all that. And also, I will see that we need to look at the missing data also. That means the reporting of the cases, how much complete it is. Also, we are looking at the death part, which you rightly mentioned. So this is important. So we have to look at, you know, also, you know, the subsequently, I will come to the evidence base, you know, with regard to the management part of it also. But these are some of the things which I really look at from the epidemiological perspective.
Okay, interesting that you say that. Dr. Mahapatra, would you like to weigh in on this one as well?
First of all, I completely agree with what Dr. Sushila said. And the point is, definitely, these figures have their potential bias among them. And while talking about the exact numbers or the absolute numbers, those are only indicative. But we need to understand what is the secondary attack rate, what are different kinds of infection spread related indicators that is going on, like R0, R0, R1, etc. We also need to understand that what is the hospital bed occupancy rate and what is the duration of stay in the hospital, as well as it's very important to understand and have a measure of what amount of home isolations are actually going on. So these are different kind of things. Put together, we can get a complete idea about whether the peak is over or not. But given that, from the epidemiological concept of there is a regression to mean because of different kind of errors having different kind of reasons for getting underestimated, but there is always a chance of having a kind of trend which will talk about the percentage of the patients that you are actually being able to catch on the radar. Based on that, as both of you rightly said, that there are states where the peak seems to be over, but there are states which are picking up. And because the states where we are seeing that the worst for the second wave might have passed, there is always a risk of having either a third wave or a repeat surge, even in this second wave, because it's only a matter of month when we are actually talking about sub-exponential growth changing to exponential growth and then plateauing and then coming down. Too fast. Everything that we are talking about, these things are too fast. Now, there is always a chance of having a third wave. And there are requirement of continuing to have a surveillance system capturing all these indicators that I just mentioned to understand that are we in a position to even breathe little bit of easily that with anything is over. I think no, because there are several things. You are talking about death. The point is somebody who is a new case. Every time, every graph that you are showing, you are talking about new cases or cumulative number of cases. But a case after getting admitted, if that person got a bed, there will be a certain period of time when the person will be treated there. If the first week is taken care of properly, that means if we could have actually had proper kind of support sometime budesonide, and after that when actually by monitoring other kind of blood parameters to see whether the CRP, interleukin 6, things we are being able to monitor, then there will be a time when some patient will go into more severe condition and some patient not. Now, those severe conditions will appear in these deaths if death is being recorded from only there. And there will be other deaths which actually, because of not finding the bed, not reaching the right place at right time, given all these things, there is always a chance that there will be a delay in the death coming down from the cases coming down. And there are several reasons of errors in the data that was previously mentioned. Those errors will continue to underestimate the actual number, but overall the trend will ultimately be similarly same. So overall my message for this question to you is definitely there are indicators that we need to look at, but it's time to keep an eye on for the continuum of these indicators over time.
Well, you've made actually an extremely interesting point that I want to highlight, you know, and because I also spoke about the daily death count that we're looking at, which is still on the, you know, an extremely high level. We saw 4,300 deaths being reported yesterday. If you look at this data now, we are literally the worst in this in the entire world. And all of us on this panel will agree it doesn't even really capture the true picture. But there is a delay, which is why the cases are coming down. But obviously, because there is still a lot of stress in the hospitals, we are still seeing a higher death figure. Then, Dr. Chauhan, would it be fair to say that up until the death data begins to come down and actually comes down significantly, we can't even say that the stress on our healthcare infrastructure has gone away, let alone say that we are on a proper path to recovery?
That two quick comments. Can you hear me? Okay. Hello?
Yes, absolutely.
So quickly, one is the, I just summarized the previous comments made by the two experts. Now, one is that you look at the data as it is presented and don't doubt it. The other is, we can argue till the cows come back that have we got all the data? Is there enough RT-PCR? Is this gone to rural areas? Are we mapping that up or not? That opens up questions and therefore cannot be answered because we don't. Should we do all that? Of course we should do all that. Are we doing that? Perhaps not. But let's take the numbers as you presented. You summarize it beautifully, and let's only for a minute imagine these numbers are real numbers. Otherwise, you know, these questions can never be tackled because you always have so many variables that we don't control. So therefore, argument can be this way or that. There always will be lag period depending on, in India, of course, we already know, lag period of 11 to 17 days, depending on which state, where the oxygen supply was not low, et cetera, et cetera. So what you see, the number of cases today, the result of this vis-a-vis deaths, a severe disease, you will reflect that only after about 3 weeks. And I think the time is word over about 12 to 17 or 12 to 18 days. In India, you can make it 3 weeks. So if the number, again, I say a very big if, because if I open variables, let's look at the current number. We simply would say, if the peak was 4 lakhs, let's say 5 days back, and if the death rate will come down, you are going to see that from 15 to 20 days everywhere. So I would summarize this as saying that, yes, because of lockdowns, major lockdowns in Delhi, Maharashtra, in Kerala, wherever the lockdowns are, you would see a proportionate decline in death. we saw a very large number of deaths primarily because suddenly the infrastructure was stretched even in our top towns. Now, hopefully that situation is behind us, as we seem to feel that is behind us. So I would say wait another 2 weeks, you will see a decline. You should see a decline. That's the trend world over. This is not a trend only in India. It takes about 12 days to 20 days to see the decline in death. So you may see as many deaths tomorrow because people are in the hospital, people are on ventilators, people are on oxygen. They are still breathing. Hopefully they'll come out. And I think you'll see tapering off in 2 weeks' time. But if we keep talking about variables, whether we do enough RT-PCR, is this the current picture? That's another debate. I think that debate is totally different debate.
Correct. Yeah, these numbers can't be, you know, really discussed at all. So we've done our part of actually pointing out that there do exist these variables and that they are legitimate ones. But this is the information that we have right now. So let's see if we can pick out a larger trend from this. Dr. Sita Prasanna, let me bring you in as well on this conversation. The last, in the first wave, the peak that we saw in our country was roughly about the one-third or one-fourth of the levels that we're already seeing now. So that's the big gap any which ways with what the second wave has brought on. But what does your research and analysis show? Are we peaking already or is the worst yet to come for daily cases?
All right. So since you brought up the first wave, let me just point out that the biggest difference between the first wave and the second wave is that in the first wave, we started from very low numbers. And so therefore, it's not a surprise that the absolute number of cases that we are talking about in the second wave, which started already from, quite a large initial number of cases, would be order of magnitude larger than the first wave. The most interesting difference between the first wave and second wave, though, is not so much the numbers, but how quickly the spreading rate, which is measured by the effective reproduction number, is changing. So if you look at the first wave, when it broke, it had a reproduction number of close to 1.9. So let me remind the viewers that the reproduction number is essentially the average number of people a single infected person would pass on the infection to. So if you have a reproduction number of 2, that means that each infected person on average is infecting 2 others before that person is either quarantined or cured or unfortunately dying. So essentially it would be doubling every few days, so that depends upon the generation interval, which is roughly about 5 days. So if the reproduction number is 2, we would see the number of cases doubling every 5 days or so. Now, the higher the reproduction number, obviously the faster the disease is spreading. And if it comes down to 1, that means that the infected person is just barely able to reproduce herself so that, the number of cases remaining almost steady. And once it goes below 1, essentially the number of cases is going down. So what we saw in the case of India in the first wave was that when it started, it had a reproduction number of about 1.9. And following the imposition of the lockdown in late March, in early April, it came down to 1.5. And then eventually in mid-April, it went down to 1.3. Thereafter, it kept steadily decreasing, but it remained above 1 till mid-September. So that's the interesting part. We had a complete lockdown over the entire country, but it still took about 6 months for the reproduction number to go below 1, where for the first time, we started seeing the number of active cases decreasing. Now, what do we see in the second wave? So once it went down below 1 in mid-September, the reproduction number remained less than 1 until mid-February or thereabouts. And then in mid-February, for the first time, India's reproduction number again rose above 1 and quickly became again 1.3, in March and most of April, it remained 1.3. Lately, what we have seen is that it started decreasing again. And so, for example, between April 30 to May 8, it was about 1.1. And then very interestingly, from May 9th, it's actually been less than one. So currently it stands about 0.84, which is extremely interesting because it's never been this low before, not even, you know, during the aftermath of the total lockdown. So I would, you know, suspect that this is just a small fluctuation. You know, we are reading too much into just a few days worth of trends. So, you know, we have to wait for a bit longer to see if this is a sustained trend or not. And you can also link this particular number to essentially improvement of the epidemic situation to the two leading states, the who are leading in terms of the total number of active cases. So the situation has improved both for Maharashtra, which has remained below one essentially from April 24, more about that later, and also Karnataka, which very recently was, you know, still had, you know, quite a substantial reproduction number. So between April 30 to May 7, the first week of May was like 1.25. But after that, it came down to 1.04. And very recently, it seems to be actually hovering very close to one. So, you know, it's almost like flattening out. So it's partly to do with the improvement in these two states that the India-wide R value has actually gone to, you know, around 0.84 or thereabouts. But if the situation deteriorates for, you know, a few other states, which could then come up in terms of the number of active cases, we could actually see the R value for India again going up.
Okay, so you say that you do, you know, we could expect the R0 value to go up again, which is fair enough. And I want to come back to this, you know, data point and what it reflects in just a bit. But let me also bring in Dr. Jayalal, National President for the Indian Medical Association, because Dr. Jayalal, while official figures of daily cases, recoveries, you know, positivity rate and number of tests being conducted do help us paint a certain kind of picture. Another good way of actually judging what the situation is what's happening on ground. What is the state within our hospitals now? Will you be able to give us any insights on if there, yes, you know, the burden as it was, say, 2 weeks ago has begun to come down? And I mean outside of the big cities like Mumbai and Delhi, which were largely in focus.
Yeah, definitely now that the few states are having the positive result, and as he has rightly said, with the Maharashtra and Delhi, then we are seeing the decline in the R factor. But what is worrying for us is the spread of the disease from the metropolitan cities to the rural area. Now what we see in a shift focus, now almost 65% to 70% of the disease, now it is epicentered around the rural area. Unfortunately, the percentage of the vaccination what we could achieve in the rural area is less than 15%. So that is further possibility of spreading of the disease much more in the rural area. Then most of the metropolitan areas where we could see the reduction in the R factor is where we have already achieved some kind of vaccination has been able to do. That the zero negativity was there, and that is the one positive trend we are having. But as the disease is spreading towards the rural area, where the disease, we definitely have a lack of infrastructure and lack of accessibility to certain drugs, and even the manpower will be less. There is a worrisome problem, but I am confident and I'm thankful to the statistic which is shown. And if there is an overall trend that we are seeing that a decline in the R factor, definitely we will see, at least if not in immediately, at least within a week or two, that we will see a decline in the number of cases. And that is a good sign for us to see to that our efforts are taking place. I fully agree with him. The lockdown has played a major role on that. But what we are seeing in the lockdown, if it is in the rural area, also we can see enforce it in a much more better way. Still, the decline what we are seeing in the metropolitan cities will be able to see in the rural area. Now, I appeal our entire focus has to shift from the big cities, what we are talking, has to go through the rural areas so that we will be able to see some positive results in the days to come.
Yes, actually, you know, because you've raised this point, let me also bring in, go back to Dr. Garg, because Dr. Sunila Garg in the beginning was talking about how, so these are some of the things that we need to now look at. And yes, plan has been made, guidelines have also been issued on how to tackle it, the kind of approach that needs to be taken for to handle the COVID spread, which has now hit our rural countryside. Dr. Garg, One, of course, important fact will be to not only ensure that we have the correct picture as to what is happening, but of course ensure that there is enough help available. Now, is stricter lockdown perhaps one of the key things we need to ensure? Because any which ways, providing a city-like healthcare infrastructure in villages is next to impossible.
Definitely. What you said is absolutely right. But I will also say, I like to compliment what Dr. Jailal has said, that basically if we look at our country is very big. And under Ayushman Bharat also, if we look at, there is variation in the healthcare facilities between different states also. If we look at state of Chhattisgarh or if we look at state of Bihar, the number of health and wellness centers, the functionality of health and wellness centers is definitely different. So, basically that is where we need to look at, how much functional each of these centers is when we talk about, the community care centers, or we look at the dedicated COVID care centers, or we look at the district hospitals. Because the main focus, the advantage of the rural area is that we have got frontline workers who are visiting from house to house. A second advantage I'll say is that each frontline worker goes for 1,000 population. Anganwadi worker, you can always find a record of 1,000 population with her. So when we are talking of, looking for severe acute respiratory illnesses or, influenza-like illnesses, we can get the record through our house-to-house visit. That is important. Also, they have been provided with, so we can get an approximate number of cases from there. And also, they have been provided with pulse oximetry and thermometer and all, so that they can do the needful and refer the cases to the sub-center, where, we have looked at the rapid antigen test, because we talked to also WHO experts and all. Now, what rapid antigen tests we are getting as compared to previous tests, they are more sensitive, they are much more specific, and they can be easily taught to our healthcare workers. So that is another important thing. And also a lot of empowerment is there with the panchayats and all that, so that, in rural area, the situation is little different, because people can be isolated, in the panchayat settings and all, and the shelter homes and all. That is one of the things, because community is the center stage of, intervention. That is one thing which is important. So then, from there, after if we have to do some of the RT-PCR tests and all, they will be done at the next level. That is what we call it as health and wellness center or community health center. And at the community health center, there is a 30-bedded hospital, which is going to be under the supervision of medical officer. And then comes the district COVID hospital, a dedicated COVID hospital, and district hospital. So that's where, I see that we will be able to get, not only the number of cases, but the intervention also with the help of, because our healthcare machinery is more streamlined. In the rural area, it's only a question of, as I'm again telling, that, basically different states are, if I look at Tamil Nadu has got the best infrastructure with regard to Ayushman Bharat. It is totally digitalized and all that. We will get the complete information as compared, because there is wide variation in the states also. So that's where implementation of the program right now in the rural areas is the need of the hour. And I've also, suggested and of the opinion that right now we should go for immediate assessment of the functionality of the healthcare facilities in different states. And in a time-bound manner, we should get that. And they should indicate that these facilities are made functional. Over to Tanvi.
Yes, that's the key. And while the rest of the plan sounds very encouraging on paper, it will look like that, but to make it a reality, what you said just now, Dr. Garg, is the first thing we need to do. Look at what is functional, look at what infrastructure, equipment, staff availability is even there on the healthcare centers, primary, secondary, whichever kinds are even present in the rural. And that's where I fear the picture is really, really horrifying. But let's see how it progresses from here on. Let me get back to the spread of the infection itself. And Dr. Chauhan, to you, I come with that point. We often talk about the R-naught that gives you a sense of how fast the infection is spreading. But there is obviously a change in the way the virus has started to behave now than it did a year ago. Basis that, do you think it will now take us longer to get out of this, or can the fall be as quick as the rise was?
It is more or less now accepted if not entirely established, because we haven't sequenced enough that the present wave, that waves not only in India, but in every country, be it Japan, be it Singapore, wherever, the second wave is largely driven by the mutants of the Wuhan virus. And these mutants now pretty much accepted. We have the data from the labs, from the field, from elsewhere in the world that these mutants are about 10 times more infective. So the nature of infection itself has changed. Therefore, nature of infectivity has changed. What I fail to understand, if let's say, imagine as the overall figures are, let's say the rural area, this is spread. I hope it hasn't. But from all anecdotal evidence, we think it's spread. And let's say we are in a position to map it. It is not hidden from anywhere, anyone in this country that the infrastructure in the rural area is rather fragile. Even if 1% or 2% people would require oxygen or go into severe disease syndrome, then where would they go for a treatment? So when Asha worker going visiting, all that is very bad. So I think this nature of spread has increased. There's no question. Different states will see different peaks. There's absolutely no question. That's right in front of us. Overall, after 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 5 weeks, logically, the infection comes down. If you want to stay home, you have double mask, your malls are closed, your gyms are closed. Trouble is when you reopen it, what preparation would you have made? For example, if England went into 3 months of lockdown and then aggressive vaccine, unfortunately, again, it comes down, okay, this is fine. We are in a very bad shape. I don't know how to, we hardly know how to handle it, but it will peter up. There's no question it's going to go down. It's beginning to go down as we have said. What is the preparation when we come out again? Yesterday you heard from the ministry that 98%, slightly more than what it is. Let's say 90% of us still exposed. Tomorrow when you take off, you again go to work. Someday you have to go to work. Someday you have to start earning money. Someday you have to, let's say that happens next month. The virus is still there. Mutants are still there. The infectivity is still there. So the preparation period, which is now when the infection rates are going down, instead of, you know, diverting attention to we should do this, we should do that, we have to really prepare when we reopen. How do we confront this virus again? It's not going to go anywhere. So that brings to the question, which is not point of debate today, that we need to make sure that we vaccinate as many as people. There should be no vaccine hesitancy. Even if there's small shortage for a while, we bear with it. Make sure that not a single vaccine shot is wasted. Try to get as many vaccines as possible. That's the way to prepare for it. Rural area getting high infectivity is bad news. And I think that will be very difficult to handle. But if we can't get oxygen in Delhi or in Mumbai, what chance would you get in a rural setting in Jharkhand or in Bihar, for that matter, anywhere in the country? So we need to be extremely cautious, and as the other speaker has said.
Yes.
Other speaker said the surveillance right now of every kind.
No, you're absolutely right.
Of the mutants, of the number of people getting infected, number of people dying, how many people need will get severe disease, all that needs to be done. But we know, I mean, all of us have been saying this for very long. This is a time when we should all unite, put every effort, whatever. But beyond anything, I think that your viewers should really get one message. The best way to fight mutants or the original virus or the future virus would be extremely disciplined to have double masking all the time. If you do that in rural area today, you will absolutely stop the virus spread. So that's the message. That's a simple message. If Asha Barkar can go and put double masks in rural area, that's what you need to do. Tanvi.
Yes, perhaps, you know, at an earlier stage, we would have hoped that that's what could have been done. But I think we also systemically woke up to what the situation was in rural India very late, when the big cities had begun to get hit by the second wave and begun to bring in curbs and people moved back to their rural areas. At that time, none of these states were actually even looking and at tracking these people, isolating them, quarantining them, all the steps that we took in during the first wave. And it's so unfortunate because in first wave, we knew what had to be done. We did that and we managed to contain it. And this time, we completely forgot about that part of the story and now it's hit us bad. And the horrifying stories that come every day. If I can just go back to Dr. Sitabhra Sinha as well on this. Dr. Sitabhra Sinha, what I wanted to also ask you is, obviously our country, each region, each state, each sometimes even district behaves differently. Even for what is called India's first wave, many of the states saw multiple, you know, waves during that period. Any interesting insights that you can share with us basis what you've studied right now, what the numbers show you this time around?
I absolutely agree that, you know, and this is the point also one of the panelists made, that India is like a continent. Each of the states, you know, are behaving like, you know, different countries when it comes to something like COVID. However, you know, one interesting difference I find between the first wave and the second wave is that the first wave actually discernibly peaked at very different times in different states. Compared to that, the second wave actually hit most of India almost simultaneously. So essentially, you know, we did see, you know, as I said, you know, most of India, essentially the epidemic was... the first wave was gone by mid-September, and we had a lull, which lasted till about mid-February. The only exception was Kerala, which in January showed, you know, a resurgence, but that was, again, quickly contained. But starting mid-February, first Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, Punjab, and then the rest of the states, one by one, fell like dominoes to the second wave. And that happened very fast. You know, essentially, by 4 weeks, most of India had been in the grips of the second wave. So the second wave had actually been much more, in some sense, well coordinated all over India compared to the first wave. However, saying that, you know, I do agree that there's been a lot of heterogeneity if we look at district-level data. So, for example, if we just take, you know, for the sake of example, Orissa, which currently has, you know, a production number of about 1.1, which has gone down from 1.23, you know, in the first week of May. This decline is primarily due to the improvement of the situation in the urban areas of Bhubaneswar and Cuttack. But if you look at, for example, the districts of Koraput, Meerut or Kandamal, the situation is completely different. I mean, Koraput, for example, over the period April 24 to May 18, you see a, you know, almost a textbook example of an exponential growth in the number of cases with a reproduction number of 1.35. Meerut is a very interesting case because between April 9 to May 2, it had an extremely high reproduction number of, you know, greater than 1.5. And then in the first week of May, it just went down to 1.07, and we thought that, you know, essentially we are seeing something like a flattening. And then much to our surprise, last week we saw that it's risen again to 1.4, which basically tells us that, you know, we have to be extremely cautious before declaring victory over the second wave, because we have seen multiple cases, for example, in Chhattisgarh and in Madhya Pradesh, where R came down, in case sometimes it came down below one, and then, you know, within a week, it was back again, almost close to its old rate. Now, some of the, you know, conversation which rotated around this case of, you know, how much of the cases are we missing, or, you know, is the rural cases being underreported and so on. So I just like to point out that from the numbers, what we notice is that, for example, the district of Kandamal, again, showing another textbook example of exponential growth in number of cases with a reproduction number of 1.3 over the first half of May. Now, what we notice is that essentially most of these districts showed exponential growth until it reaches numbers of about 1,000 or 2,000 And then depending upon, let's say, the population or the population density of that particular district, it starts showing a flattening. What we don't know is whether this is because of the genuine flattening in the true number of cases, or whether this is because the testing capacity for that particular district has been saturated. The saturation is consistent with both of these explanations. So again, I guess, from the analysis of the numbers, the point we'd like to make is that although right now the situation seems to be, quite optimistic in the sense that several states, including Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, seem to have reproduction number less than one, we ought to be careful because we are still not able to disentangle the effect of, let's say, saturation in testing with a genuine decrease or with a genuine break in the chain of infection.
Well, I also want to point out at this moment that in many of the places where we are seeing a decline in cases, is also there has been a plateauing to a drop in testing as well. Now, there are multiple reasons that we've given. Sometimes we say that, well, during the worst of the times when the testing was peaking in these states, the test labs became overburdened. And so gradually that had to come down any which ways because they couldn't take that load. They couldn't carry out so many tests any which ways. But if since the testing's come down in some of the states where we are seeing a decline, we obviously need to then watch out for a longer time, Dr. Jayalal, to see what is the true picture. If there is actually a significant relief coming in, whether it's Maharashtra or even Delhi or even the plateauing that we're seeing in states like Gujarat and Karnataka, isn't it?
It is too much we talk about this R factor. It is ready. All that is, for our discussion and epidemiological research, and it is good. But what is seeing in the practically in the person in the rural area, if you are doing, we talk about the testing. When you do the testing today, it takes minimum 3 days for him to get the result because there is no adequate testing laboratories are there. It takes invariably 2 to 3 days for the person to get the result. And meantime, all that 2 to 3 days, and he is the most potent spreader of the disease. And he thinks that he is not positive, but he is still spreading the disease. And other criteria, as you said rightly, when you are talking about the oxygen now it present in the rural area. Though we have now enough production, but since there is a lack of cryogenic tankers to take the oxygen to the rural areas, and especially in the private setup, and this oxygen is still in a shortage in many parts of the country, and especially in Tamil Nadu and other areas also, we are seeing acute difficulty in getting the oxygen. And even in a medical college, where the public sector medical college, where every day we are just living within 1 hour and 3 hours, that is what the login period with which that it is going on. So unless, without talking on that factors, then this R factor is reduced, where we are not able to get a comprehensive picture of the R factor. But now we should realize then what is exactly happening in the rural area and augment our force to that. Yes, Anganwadi workers can go and see in the villages and see in the house is not going to get any help. And how many Anganwadi workers will be able to go? And what we are seeing practically is many of them are getting infected. And we are getting the people that if you see the medical colleges in the rural area or the hospital in the rural area, the many of the healthcare workers are now admitted. So we need to get in a war front. We should take that decision and something very concrete that we should do for the society at the rural area. All the augmentation of the manpower, augmentation of the resources which is needed for that, and augmentation of the testing. Unless we are going to do the testing adequately and testing and trace is not being done, I'm sure that we will not be able to follow. We will be only living in the paradox and saying that, and in particular part that is our factory already, so that we are going to lose. But the amount of spread which is happening in the rural area is tremendous. Now we are seeing 25 to 30% is a positivity. That means every alternative patient or every 1/4 of the patient, what we are going to see is a patient is the positiveness. And where to go ahead for that infrastructure for them to accommodate. So let us, now it is a time the country should focus entirely on the rural area. 65 to 70% of the cases are now loaded in the rural area. Now we need to shift the focus and do that on the practical ground than staying on a theoretical point in the war room discussion.
Yes, no, actually, just to add to that, Dr. Jayalal, you know what the guidelines are, what the center's plan as it has been drawn. We were talking to Dr. Sunila Garg about it earlier as well. Now tell us how practical is it to implement that? We know what the reality is of many parts of our rural, of our smaller towns and even villages. Obviously, state to state it differs. But in states like Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Bihar, it is extremely bad. It's non-existent. You know, I mean, for the longest time, Bihar had only 5 dedicated COVID hospitals for the entire state. So even if we say that we will have one COVID center with 30 beds for, you know, each of these zones, how practical is it to carry this out in rural villages?
So it is very difficult at this moment to carry out, but only thing what we need to do that is if we can say the opportunity for the testing of the people and the containment of the spread is if we be able to be implemented, that will be possible. But simultaneously, as rightly said by Dr. Saugan sir, we need to mass vaccination program has to be launched in the rural area, because that is going to help us in a long run to curtail this disease. And that will be the good opportunity for us to do with a door-to-door campaign, like what we have already know that is a infrastructure facilities available to the limited level. And if we can take this opportunity to vaccinate the people, and simultaneously when we are taking care of the treatment of the people in the hospital, and that can give at least in the tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, it can give us a dividend for that. In the first wave also, what we see is the initially it was from the metropolitan city, it went to the rural area, but that is happening here, but we are not adequately prepared to face that situation. Now, 30-bed hospital, if it is there in the rural area, it is not going to be of any help. Any way it is going to help. We need to make a mass area, because there is a lot of areas are available, some schools are available, like what the maximum hospitals should be made, and the diversion of the faculties and diversion of the manpower from the cities where it is already we have seen a plateauing should be shifted to the rural area. And I mean, adequate war food like focus has to be given for the rural area to get some success rate at this moment.
Yeah. Okay, fair enough. I am completely out of time, so I'm going to thank all of the panelists for joining us on this conversation. Let me just quickly also summarize it for our viewers. Yes, there is a decline in daily cases that we're looking at after the worst kind of levels, above 4 lakh cases per day that we saw earlier this month. And from there, we've come down to 2.6 lakh cases per day. It's still much higher than the peak we saw in the first wave. Remember that. Pretty much most states have the tightest of the curbs or lockdowns in place right now. So you are beginning to see an impact of that. The death count on a daily basis remains extremely high. It doesn't even capture the full reality, and it is high, and probably it will begin to only show a decline in a few more days, because that's the lag, a couple of weeks lag between the cases and deaths that experts say is visible. But if you've only been hearing about how recoveries have been higher than active cases, how positivity rate is coming down, how more districts are now looking at below 10% positivity rate, remember that India's biggest challenge has just begun now, which is what's happening in rural India. If cities like Mumbai, Bengaluru, Pune, Hyderabad, Delhi, Lucknow, Ahmedabad went through the worst of the times and the worst kind of nightmares because of lack of enough healthcare infrastructure, whether it was beds, ICU beds, oxygen, drugs or staff. Can you imagine now that this disease and infection has reached every single corner of our country and those smallest of the far-flung villages, what's going to happen? They have nothing over there in terms of infrastructure. Can you imagine that? So we cannot let our guard down. We need to now start pushing and preparing and asking questions about what is being done for that part of India. Thank you for joining us on this conversation.